good morning. Let me ask you a question. Have any of you ever had a problem with alignment? I mean, when it just seems like things aren't lining up. Maybe your back is out of alignment. Maybe your car is driving down the road. Or maybe even, maybe even it's your clothes that are out of alignment a little bit. We're in a series right now where we're talking about aligning our lives with God's purpose and His plan for us, that we would not be just kind of veering to the left or to the right, but we are going right down the path that God would have us go, that we would be aligned to His word, to His truth, to His life. Say with me the word alignment. Say alignment. Alignment. Alignment is such a key word. It literally means to put into position, to put things in the order they are supposed to go in, that it works the best way that it can possibly work. And we're looking at several key ways over the next several weeks of how God wants our lives to be aligned with Him. I mean, it's pretty evident when things are out of alignment. Your car goes one way or the other, you're hurting all over, or maybe you've been in a group And you're working as a team, and there just is not alignment, and you're trying to go, you're supposed to go the same direction, but somebody or the group is pulling to the left or the right, and you're just not going the direction that you need to go. Scripture's full of verses about alignment, and especially alignment of faith. I want you to look at this verse, and I want us to read it together. It's out of Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6, and it tells us how important our faith alignment is. So let's read this together. And without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to Him must believe that He exists and that He rewards those who earnestly seek Him. I mean, that's pretty clear, isn't it? I mean, if without faith, without our faith being aligned to God and going the direction He wants us to go, it is impossible. You can't do it. There's no way. It's impossible for you and me to please God. Faith is an amazing word. I use it a lot. Maybe you use it a lot. It's kind of like a multifaceted gem, like a diamond. And when you look at it and the light hits it, it just brings out all kinds of luster and illumination. It's a beautiful thing. And there's many different components or aspects to it. And this morning, I want us to look at the different facets that God wants us to align our lives according to His purpose for faith, that we are to live that out. And I can't think of any better chapter, any better passage of Scripture than the 11th chapter of Hebrews. It's known as the Hall of Faith. And it lists out people, men and women, who have put their faith in God and trusted in Him, and they had their faith properly aligned. 11th chapter of Hebrews, we find at least six different alignments of faith. And I hope you have your Bible. I invite you to turn over there to today. I'm going to have a lot of Scripture that we're going to share. We're going to look at some different verses. I'm doing it a little bit different this week. The Scripture's not going to be on the screen, and so you can follow along in your Bible. I've printed it on your outline this morning for you to use as well. But what we do is, when we look at the 11th chapter of the book of Hebrews, we see and aligned faith, and what that looks like, how it works, and how we're to work it out. The first thing that we see is this, is an aligned faith is believing even when I don't see it. An aligned faith is believing in even when I don't see it. Look at the very first verse of Hebrews chapter 11. Now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. It's confidence, it's faith, it's assurance. We don't see it, we don't grab it in front of us, but we believe it. We see it in our mind, we see it in our heart. That is faith. Faith is literally visualizing the future in the present. It's seen in advance. It's being certain of what is to come. Oh, we don't have it yet. We don't see it yet. It hasn't all come together yet, but I believe it even though I don't see it. the struggle we have in our society, maybe you that way, I'm that way, we kind of say, well, I'll believe it when I see it. You show me the money and then I'll believe it. I'll believe it when I see it right there in front of my face. But God says, you've got it completely backwards. Kind of like an architect seeing in his mind and in his thoughts this plans before he even begins to draw it out. It's maybe like a scientist working on a project trying to come to a solution, but before he even gets there, he's envisioned it in his mind. And all of those things require faith, that you have to believe that something is possible in advance. You have to believe that God is at work. I think about our very church. That years ago, even back when it began, that a group of people had a vision, had a purpose, and through those years, that vision has grown, and we're here today, you're here today. And God is still saying, I'm just beginning to do what I want to do, but you've got to believe it before you see it. You see, faith turns dreams, it turns ideas into reality. It's believing before I see it, but it's far more than that. An aligned faith is not just believing before I see it, but it's also obeying. It's obeying God, even if I don't understand it. And what an amazing thing. The scripture gives all kinds of examples, but here in chapter 11 of Hebrews, there's two key examples that I want to just share with you. One is Noah, and the other is Abraham. Here's Noah. This man, and he was called out for his righteousness, for his trusting in God. And if you look at verse 7 of chapter 11, it says this. It was by faith that Noah built an ark to save his family from the flood. He obeyed God, who warned him about something that had never happened before. You had to circle the words faith and obey. That there's something about our obedience that puts our faith into action, that obeying even when I don't understand it. Can you imagine what Noah was thinking? I can't even kind of put it in my mind's eye, but here's a guy. God says, I want you to build a boat. He says, a boat? What's that? Oh, we'll get some wood, put it together, make it where it will float on some water. Okay, I can do that. I'm in the middle of the land. The water's nowhere by, but I'll build a boat. And he says, why do you want me to do that, God? Because it's going to rain. Rain? What's rain? You see, it had never rained on the earth before this time. It was water from a mist that would come up from the ground. And so Noah had no concept of rain. God, what's rain? Well, it's like me taking a lake, God says, and just dumping it on your head. That's rain. And just know that it's going to come. And God's Noah's going, okay, whatever that is, I'm going to get ready for it. He obeyed even when he didn't understand it. You think how amazing that is. Would you believe something if you haven't seen it? Would you obey if you don't even understand the concept behind it? Think of Abraham. Look over in verse 8, the next verse. By faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place he would later receive as an inheritance, obeyed and went, listen to this, even though he did not know where he was going. Here's Abraham, he's 75 years old. I mean, he's getting ready to hang it up. He's going to retire. He's going to kick back. He's going to take Social Security. And God says, no, I have a different plan for you. Instead of Social Security, I've got social insecurity. And we're going to just put you out. You're 75 years old. You're just ripe. Pack up your bags. Let's get going and start taking off. And Abraham's going, where do you want me to go? Well, I'll show you. How will I know when I get there? Oh, I'll let you know. And Abraham, by faith, says, okay, God, I'm going. And he picks up he's 75 years old. I cannot even imagine that. He gets rid of everything. He picks up his family. He tells everybody, here's where we're going. And you can imagine the kind of conflict there. His kids, his grandkids, all of these people. Not his kids, they haven't been born yet. But his relatives and all of the friends and family. And they're, okay, wherever you're saying, Abe, that's where we're going. 75 years old, he's out for the adventure of his life. And I'm sure Abraham had all kinds of doubts. And yet, he obeyed, even if he didn't understand it. And what's amazing, he became the father of the nation of Israel, and actually our father, the father of faith. Faith always involves taking a risk. Not a crazy risk, not a blind risk. It's not like going to the slot machine and putting your money. It's not a silly risk. It's risking that God has said to do something, and God, I don't understand it. I don't see it. It doesn't make any sense, but I'm going to obey you. I'm going to do what you tell me to do. You see, every time God tells you to do something, it's a test. The words lie, it's laid out in God's word. And every time God says, I want you to do this, I want you to do that, it's a test. Are you going to trust in yourself? Or are you going to trust in God? Are you going to obey him and go his direction? Or are you just going to follow your own way? But every time I obey God, he says, I'm going to, in time, bless you. And a lot of times it doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense to, when you put it all together. When God says, I want you to forgive. And you go, how can I forgive? Don't you know what they did to me? Don't you know what they said to me? Don't you know how they acted towards me? And God says, I understand. I want you to forgive. Because he knows you, that it's more about you than the other person, that you don't need to carry that resentment and that bitterness and that anger that would put you in a cage. And so God says, let it go. And you may not understand it, but you obey it, and you do what he tells you to do. Here's the point. If you do what God tells you to do, even when it seems absurd, God says, I can bless your life. But if you don't do what I tell you to do, then how do my hands come to you and bless you? I asked Paula one time, can you think of a time that you obeyed God when he told you to do something and it didn't make sense at all? She said, oh, sure, when God told me to marry you. You see, sometimes it doesn't make sense, but God has a plan. Faith is believing when I don't see it. It's obeying even when I don't understand it. And the third thing is that an alignment faith is giving when I don't even have it. Now, I'm not talking about taking your money and going to spend it on things that really God's not telling you to spend it on. It's taking the money you're supposed to be paying on bills and using it to go out and eat or going out and play and things like that. I'm not talking about being irresponsible. I'm talking about putting God first, even in your finances. Putting God first, not just in your words, but in your actions. Hebrews chapter 11, the very first guy that Hebrews mentions is a guy by the name of Abel. He was a son of Adam. And it says this, is that he did something and God blessed him, not because he did something great, not because he gave something great, not because he had some great accomplishment. All he did was give an offering. And it wasn't even the amount that he gave, it was how he gave it. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 4 says this, it was by faith that Abel brought a more acceptable offering to God than Cain did. Abel's offering gave evidence that he was a righteous man, and God showed his approval of his gifts. Some key words: faith, offering, evidence. That we show our faith, that we put our faith into action. Our faith gets aligned when we give, even when we don't have it to give. Oh God, I've got so much money and I've got so much responsibility. I got so many things I want to do. You see, it wasn't how much he gave that pleased God, it's that he obeyed God and gave. You can give several different ways. You can give out of faith, or you can give out of fear. You can give out of reason, or you can give out of reverence and revelation. Oh, I know what reason is. I've got a certain amount of money in my bank account. I don't really need that. I mean, it's not that I have to pay bills with it. It's not that I need to use it to go to a trip. And God, I've got this little bit of money and I'll set it aside. I'll give it to you. Somebody has a need. It makes sense. I've got enough. I'll give you my little bit that I have left over. And God says, oh, no, he says, no, you've missed the point. It's giving out of revelation when God says, no, if you put me first in your finances and you'll order your life according to my purpose and plan, then I'm going to stretch the other part. I'm going to help you manage the other part, that it will be a blessing and you'll have more than you even need. Paula and I have been married for 37 years, and before we were married, we made a decision together, and we were very upfront about it. I was, and she was, that we committed that we were going to give the first 10% of all of our increase to God. And it was hard. I mean, we were in college. We were finishing up our last year of school, and we didn't make very much money. She cleaned houses, and I was a music director at a church and student body president, had all kinds of responsibilities. And we lived in this little bitty two-room apartment, and there wasn't much there, but we gave. And we didn't give because the church needed it. We didn't give because of a special program. We didn't give because it blessed everybody else. We just gave because God told us to give. That was the reason we gave. I remember going to seminary, and we had to borrow money to move to Kansas City and be able to go to seminary. And we thought, oh, this is not right. We had to borrow money, and so how do we tithe on the money we borrowed? And so we went for several months, and we didn't tithe. But we made a record in a notebook of here's what the increase was, and God, this is what we owe you. And we got that loan paid off, and we went back and paid our tithe and got caught up. I was embarrassed to say that we didn't stay faithful for those 2 or 3 months, but God blessed us because we were making sure that God, here's your amount, we're setting it aside, and we're going to give it to you. And God blessed that. And ever since that point, when increase comes, it's not, you know, people ask me, well, is it the gross or is it the net? And I'm going, I don't care. I'm just, are you being faithful to God? As God gives you increase, are you giving him your 10%? That's the issue. I don't think it comes down to a certain number. I think it comes down to a point of faith and obedience to him, and even obedience beyond him. I hope I'm not being confusing to you. I hope I'm being real clear that it's not counting the beans. It's saying, God, you've given, and now I give back to you. And God takes that and blesses that. 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 2 and 3, in the midst of severe trial, he's talking to the church there and talking about in Corinth, he's talking about a church that took up an offering for those in need. In the midst of their severe trial, their overflowing joy and their extreme poverty welled up in rich generosity. For I testify that they gave as much as they were able, even beyond their ability. Did you know if you have a business or if you're having struggles and you're trying to have a hard time, you're having a hard time keeping things going, the best time to give is when things are difficult. The best time to give is when your business is not doing well. The best time to put things in order and do the right thing is when things don't seem so right. Oh, anybody can give when there's excess funds. Anybody can give when there's a lot, but it takes faith to be faithful to God and be obedient even when times are difficult. 2 Corinthians chapter 9 says this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. Whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion. It's not a point of arm twisting, he's saying. For God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to bless you abundantly so that in all things, at all times, having all you need, you will abound in every good work. What that tells me is this, I can't outgive God. And there'll be a lot of you that can testify to that. I can't give him back more than he's given to me because he's going to keep giving me more. Fourth thing is this, faith is not just believing when I don't see it and obeying when I don't understand it and giving when I don't have it. Faith, aligning my faith is persisting when I don't feel like it. It's the opposite of our culture. Our culture says this, if it feels good, do it. If it doesn't feel good, don't do it. Well, I just don't feel good about that right now. I just kind of feel like I want to hold on to it or do my own thing. And we've missed the whole point is then we get manipulated by our moods if we go by our feelings. You see, mature people live by their commitments, not their emotions. Emotions come and go, but commitments stand. Let me be honest with you. Sometimes I just don't feel like being around people. Sometimes I don't feel like being nice. Sometimes I don't feel like serving other people. Sometimes I don't feel like doing the work around the house. Sometimes I don't feel like putting up with some of the stuff I have to put up with. Sometimes I don't feel like reading my Bible. That shocks you, doesn't it? Sometimes I don't feel like praying. But I can tell you this, that whenever I've said, God, I don't care what I feel like, I'm going to trust in you, and I'm going to be faithful to you, and I'm going to do it anyway, that God blesses. And I will tell you this, I've learned this long enough. If I wait till I feel like it, the devil's always going to give me an excuse. He's always going to come in and he's going to give me some other reason why I don't do something or why I don't act a certain way. There's always going to be something that comes in my way. And so I have to make that commitment up front. It doesn't matter how I feel. I'm going to trust in you. I love this. One person said this, successful people are simply ordinary people who do what the average person doesn't feel like doing. Let me say that again. Successful people are just ordinary people that do what the average person doesn't feel like doing. How many times your parent and your kids cry in the middle of the night going, I don't feel like getting out of bed and taking care of them. I don't feel like changing that diaper. It doesn't really matter, does it? You do it anyway. Because that's faithfulness. That's love. And God is saying, you know, your life is that way. You persist even when you don't feel like it. It's the same with an athlete or a musician or a person. See, a godly person who persists, God, I'm going to be faithful to you. I'm going to obey you. I'm going to go where you want me to go. I'm going to do what you want me to do. I refuse to give up and I refuse to give in. I'm going to stand. And I love Ephesians 6 where Paul says this. He says, when you've done all to stand, then just stand. When you've given it all and you're about to fall, just go ahead and stand. Go ahead and faith is persistent. You look in Hebrews 11, it talks about Moses in verse 27. By faith, Moses left Egypt, not fearing the king's anger, not fearing Pharaoh's anger. He persevered, listen to this, he persevered because he saw him who is invisible. In other words, he fixed his eyes on Jesus. It's a lot easier sometimes to fix our eyes on the problems. It's easier to fix our eyes on the person that's not doing what we want them to do, or the situation that's not working out the way we, or the finances. It's easier to put our eyes there, but he says, no, you fix your eyes on Jesus and you obey him, you persist. I don't know today what you're struggling with or where the enemy's beating you up and you're just saying, you know, I'm at a place, it just seems like it's hard. And I just want to give up and walk away. I have good news for you. God has a purpose and a plan, and he's going to work that out. You just need to hang in there. You need to trust him. Don't give up. Keep believing, persisting in faith. Align your faith with Jesus. Fix your eyes on him. Look to God. I thought of this the other day. I thought, you know, if I look at my problems, I'm going to be overwhelmed. If I look at the world, I'm going to be distressed. If I look inside, I'm going to be depressed. But if I look to God, I'm going to be at rest. It's fixing my eyes on him. Two other things. One is, the next one is this. To align my faith, I need to thank God even before I receive it. Thank God even before. A good example is Joshua. You know, we looked several weeks ago at the story of Joshua and Jericho. And it says this in verse 30. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell after the army marched around them for 7 days. And you know the story. They left Egypt. They were wandering in the wilderness. They disobeyed God. They wandered in the wilderness for 40 years. They finally come into the promised land. They go, great, we're ready to claim all that God has for us. And there's this big fortress in front of them. And sometimes it's that way when it just seems like God is led and he's ready and he's saying, okay, now go. And then you start to go and you run into that brick wall, that fortress. And God said, here's how you defeat that. You don't fight them. You don't throw rocks at them. You don't throw spears at them. You don't try to shoot them and get catapults. And you just walk around the city. Just walk around the city once a day. Be quiet. Pray. Thank God. Keep walking. Next day, walk. Seventh day, walk around 7 times. And you can imagine the people on the wall by that time are just going, we're going back to bed. Seventh day, they're walking around seven times, and they let out a shout, and they blew their trumpets, and the walls came down. First, it was silence. But I'm going to tell you what. Before the walls came down, they were thanking God already for the victory. Before they saw it, they already believed it. Before they understood it, they obeyed it. Before they had it, they gave it. And then here they are, they're thanking God in advance of their faith. You see, faith is not believing that God can do something. We believe that. I don't think faith is believing that God will do something. I think faith is believing God is doing something. I think faith is knowing that God is already at work, and we don't have to beg him, and we just say, God, help me, and we know if God is at work, and he's going to work his plans out. And so even before it comes together, I can say, thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God, for coming through. God, where are you? God, you're at work, and I'm just looking forward to the victory. I'm looking forward to it all coming together. Mark chapter 11, verse 24, Jesus says this, therefore I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you've received it, that's past tense, and it will be yours, present tense. If I were to say, I want you to come up after the service and I have a $5,000 check for you, and I gave you I'm not everybody, just one of you, and I gave you a $5,000 check, and I've signed it, it's there, and I got that much in savings, and it's there. And would you wait till you cash it to thank me? Or would you say, wow, I got the check, it's thank you. Because it's legal tender, right? I have to tell you, as good as my checks are, God's are better. And he comes through with what he promises, and he does what he says he's going to do. Here's Abraham, and God says, go to a country. I'm not even going to show you where you're going, but you just go. And he went, and he trusted, and he believed, even when he didn't fully understand, because he knew that God was faithful to his promise. And God's promises to you to be faithful, to trust him, to believe in him. You don't wait till prayer's answered to thank him. You thank him now because he's going to answer. You persist in prayer. God, thank you that the answer's on the way. Thank you that you're going to come through. I heard one preacher talk about faith this way. He says, if God tells you to go after Moby Dick in a rowboat, be sure you bring the tartar sauce. I like that. Sixth thing is this. To align my faith, I need to trust in God even if I don't get it. Do you hear that? But I just said, I'm going to believe that I'm going to get it. I'm going to believe God's at work. I'm going to trust God. I'm going to know that God is at work. Yes, he is. But I'm going to trust God even if he doesn't give it in my time frame and in my specs. You see, God is not a vending machine. We don't go in there and put a little 50-cent prayer in there and God gives us a little candy bar. And he's not a vending machine that way. That he says, I'll meet all your needs according to my riches and glory, not all your greeds. You catch that? God is not something that we can just say, well, here's my prayer. Here's my problem. And that I'll never have a problem. I'll never get sick. I'll never have a difficulty. That's not in the Word. The Word is saying that God is interested in my character more than my comfort. That God is working in me. He's shaping me. And faith is trusting, even if I don't get it right now. Here's the truth. God hears and answers every prayer. Here's the second truth. God doesn't always answer the prayers the way we think he ought to answer them. Sometimes he says no. No, you're not going to get that. Sometimes he says, yes, you're going to get that. Sometimes he says, not yet. And sometimes he says, I've got a better idea. I'm going to give you something different. And all four of those are valid. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 39. They're men and women of faith all through history, and it summarizes it here. It says, these were all commended for their faith, yet none of them, listen to this, yet none of them received what had been promised, since God had planned something better for us, so that only together with us would they may be made perfect. They believed, and yet they didn't fully receive just then. But they did receive in God's timing and in God's way. That you see, anybody can trust when things are going great. Anybody can trust when things are working out and boy, it's all rosy and everybody's healthy and the money's there and it's just everybody's happy. Boy, I can trust God. The challenge is when you're in the valleys and you're in the difficulties, that God says, even then, trust me. How is it that God shapes your faith and my faith? I think he does it two ways. First way he does it is through his word. That when we get into his word, he speaks to us and he guides us and he shapes us. And that's the reason we encourage you. That's the reason we use the word in our preaching. That's why we teach the word. That's the reason we say read the word. Get in a Bible reading plan. Do the SOAP method when you're looking at scripture and observation and you're writing these things down in application and you're praying the scripture. Don't just read a devotional book that tells you all about the things outside the scripture. Get into the word. Because the word's going to outlast the devotion. The word's going to outlast everything else. And every sermon, the word's going to outlast that. Because it's alive. And so you get into the word and let it shape you. Romans 10, verse 17 says this, faith. Listen to this. Faith comes from hearing the message. And the message is heard through the word of Christ. That's the spiritual food. That's the growth point. That's how we learn and we become. That's how we develop faith. If you don't get in the word, you can have some faith, but it's not going to be a whole lot of faith. It's going to be a pretty weak faith. But when you get into the word, that little bit of faith begins to grow. That mustard seed begins to develop. And that faith becomes mighty. I think the second way that God shapes us and works in us to align our faith is through our trials. In our tests. I wish I could say, come to Jesus and everything be perfect. I wish I could say, come to Jesus and you'll never have a care and you'll never have a need. But that's not the world we live in. But I will tell you this, come to Jesus and he's going to see you through every need and every care that you have. Come to Jesus and put him first. And the scripture says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness and all these other things will be added unto you. I believe in that. Trust in him. 1 Peter chapter 1 says this, these trials will show that your faith is genuine. Listen to that. God gives us tests and trials not to hurt us, but to strengthen us, to develop us. These trials will show that your faith is genuine. It's being tested as fire tests and purifies gold. Through faith, your faith, though your faith is far more precious than mere gold. So when your faith remains strong through many trials, it will bring you much praise and glory and honor on the day when Christ Jesus is revealed to the whole world. This week I had surgery, and up till this morning I had a big old bandage on my hand, and I've got trigger fingers. Some of you don't know what those are, but it's when your tendon in your finger gets caught in the little sleeve, and it's got a kind of a nodule on it, and your finger gets stuck. And so when I'm going up a ladder, my fingers sometimes get stuck. And I got to pop it loose, and it kind of freaks everybody out because they hear it next door, you know. Or I'm using a hammer, and my hand will get stuck on the hammer, and I got to pop it loose. And my wife just, ugh. So they went in, and they cut those sleeves. And at first, you know, I said, do I need to leave it straight? Do I need to kind of just, no. From the very time you begin to wake up, even though you can't feel your fingers, you need to start stretching your fingers back and you need to bend them over. You need to stretch them back. You need to bend them. Well, why do you, it seems to me I would be better. It would heal better if I didn't move it. And he says, oh no, if you don't move it, it begins to build up scar tissue and you'll lose the mobility that you did have even with the trigger finger. And so the whole time in this surgery and this recuperation, I'm going, oh, pulling it back, and I'm pushing it down, and I'm pulling it back. And it hurts a little bit, I have to be honest. But I'm shaking with this hand and not this hand. But the issue is the same with our faith. that sometimes God does surgery on us, and he's trying to open up a passage, and what we want to do is, oh, don't touch me there, don't move me there, I don't want to, it's just too hard. And God's going, oh, no, you've missed the point. I've got to stretch you there through that testing, through that trial, because that's where the flexibility, that's where the strength, that's where the blessing, that's where the healing comes. And what's been fascinating, even now I'm beginning to feel more use of the hand. It's not clicking. This hand, I could do it, it would click. This hand is not clicking. Through trials and through testing, and what a simple little illustration. But you know that all of life is connected, that God is at work in every aspect of your life. And that when trials and difficulties come, he's going, I'm not trying to hurt you, I'm trying to help you. That God will use difficulties to strengthen your faith. We say test your faith. But he's saying, I'm going to work in you to shape you and mold you to be the person I want you to be. So trust in me. I want you to think this morning. We're going to close this way. Think about these six different facets. It's a diamond, right? It's faith. And we look at faith from these different standpoints. And for some people, they love looking at faith from this side. And others like, and it makes sense over here. And others look at it. What is God saying to you? What is the one area that the Holy Spirit is speaking to you this morning to say, here's where, ouch, ouch, that hurts, God. What's the one area that God is trying to say to you, this is where I'm wanting to put you back in alignment? Is it believing, though you don't see it? That you're walking by faith and not by sight? Is it obeying, even when you don't understand it? Is it saying, yes, Lord, even before it comes about, I'm going to sign that blank check and I'm going to go whatever you say? Is it giving when you're saying, God, I don't have it? But God's going, but this is what I've told you to do. Obey me. Don't do this. Do this. Is it your finances? Is it persisting? Are you at a place where you're just going, you know what? I'm struggling right now. And I'm ready just to throw in the towel. And God's going, get your eyes off yourself and get it back on me. Fix your eyes on Jesus. And you need to persist. You need to trust in God. Maybe that's the point. You need to thank God in advance. Is that where you are? You need to thank God in advance of him doing what he's going to do. You don't see it. It doesn't make any sense. It just is not going to happen. I love what the missionary William Carey said, Hudson Taylor said this. He says that God works in three ways. Difficult or impossible is the first way. It's impossible, God, it won't happen. Difficult, okay, God, it could happen, but I don't see how it's going to happen. It's too hard. Done. It's done. Do you need to thank God in advance? Or the sixth way, do you need to trust him right now, even though you're not getting it? You just need to stay firm in his grace. What is the Holy Spirit pointing out to you? I want you to pray with me. And I just call you to be faithful to God today. To say, Lord Jesus, we've come before you today and your word is spoken. And this chapter in Hebrews 11 is written for us. It's a picture of all of these people who have lived by faith, and some of them never received what you promised them, but they have now. And the truth is, we've been the recipients of their promise. We've received Christ. We've received your blessing. We've received your Holy Spirit. And because of the promise you made to them, it has been fulfilled now for us. And now us, in our lives, need to be faithful for the next generation, for our kids, for our spouse, for your kingdom. Lord, speak to each of our hearts right now. What's God saying to you? Where are you struggling? Where is God wanting to put his finger and align your life in his faith? Faith in Jesus, faith in the cross, faith in his purpose and his plan. To believe, to obey, to give, to to persevere and hang on, to persist, to thank Him, to trust in Him. I want you to stand with me this morning. And we're just going to take a couple of minutes just to spend in the presence of the Holy Spirit. And if God is speaking to you today and you need to just say, God, here's this area you're pointing out to me, and I want to be responsive to you. I want to right now step out in faith. We have altars. These altars are a place just to come and make commitments to the Lord, to hear God's voice, to have people pray with you, and to say, God, I'm serious about this. I mean business. Oh, you can stay where you are and do work with God. But how much faith does that take? So right now, I just invite you where you are. Step out. Have you put your faith in Jesus Christ? Are you trusting in Him as your Lord and Savior? If you haven't, why not right now? Say, Lord Jesus, forgive me of my sin. If you put your trust in Christ and yet you found yourself going back into disobedience and you're strained in your relationship with Christ, and right now I want you to say, God, I'm going to make it right, and I come to you and forgive me and work in my life and restore me and redeem me. Today you may recognize that there's a battle going on in you between what's right and what's wrong, that you love God and yet you love the world, and you need to deal with that battle, and you need to surrender it all to the Lord. You need to be sanctified and holy. Maybe right now, you've been a believer for a while, but you've just been living in the wilderness. And God is saying, enter in. Trust me. Step out in faith and live in me. Father, you know our needs today. You know that each one of us face the trials and the difficulties and the challenges of life. But today we declare by faith that Jesus Christ is Lord. We declare by faith today that you have forgiven us of our sins. We declare by faith today that you are our rock and our redeemer. We declare by faith today that we don't have to live under the control of sin, but we can live by your Spirit. We declare today that we are more than conquerors through Christ who gives us strength. We declare today that we are your children and we have received manifold grace upon grace. We declare today that you are our provider, that you will supply all of our needs according to your riches in Christ Jesus. We declare today that you are our praise and we worship you. Thank you today for your grace and your mercy that continues to work in us, to shape us, to align our lives with your word and your purpose. Lord, we give you praise today. Continue to lead us, align us in your purpose and plan for us in faith. In Jesus' name we pray.
And one of the things we recognize about faith is that it's an ongoing conversation. And so if you continue to have questions or just want to know more, feel free to talk to one of the pastors, talk to your grow group leader, because we want to continue the conversation, because this is not just about a one-time message. This is about how God is at work through every single day of our lives. And so we want to continue to do that and give Him the glory, because He is at work. And because He is doing great things, we can trust Him. Also, remember, we're still taking pictures for the directory and just want to get you some Christmas pictures. You guys know you need those. And so in the atrium over here to the right-hand side, Danielle Bertuch will be taking pictures. We'll do that right all the way up until Grow Group starts at 11 and after Grow Groups today. But we want to just continue to remind you, invite people to come to church. But more importantly, invite them to come to a relationship to Jesus Christ, because He makes the difference, not just the place. And so invite them. Remind them and tell them who Jesus is, because that makes the difference, because we're supposed to be all about one thing, which is connecting people to a vibrant life in Jesus Christ.